Good evening, everyone. Good evening and Merry Christmas. My name is David Bob. I serve as director of Hillsdale College's Kirby Center. We are thrilled to welcome you to this evening's Kirby Center lecture series. It's the final one of this year, and you're sure not to be disappointed. We're here tonight on a week in which Congress has done something of signal importance. I'm sure you all have heard about this. The Congress this week took the time to strike from the legislative record the word lunatic. Instead, they said what they ought to do is just simply insert the word Congress. On this day, 225 years ago, Delaware became the first state to ratify the Constitution. That painting there depicts the day on which it was signed. A noted Delawarean, Joe Biden, today Vice President, issued a statement about this important date. I guess it was a little different in that it turned out to be about twice as long as the Constitution itself. On a much more serious note, though, we are gathered today on Pearl Harbor Day. Last year, the Pearl Harbor Survivors Association disbanded, their members either having passed on or too old not to continue. As of last year, Congress no longer issues a commemoration of that day, having decided to issue no such commemorations except when they break the rule to issue commemorations. As we reflect on the sacrifice of our men and women in uniform, I'd like to ask all of those who have served the United States or are currently serving to please stand. It's fitting that tonight we take up the topic, Time to Give Up or Time to Fight On. And it's most fitting that Dr. Larry Arnn address this topic. The 12th president of Hillsdale College will be introduced by Hillsdale College junior, Jonathan Moeller. With a major in politics and a minor in German, Jonathan has spent this semester interning as part of the Washington Hillsdale internship program at the Heritage Foundation, where he's worked in the Center for Politics and Principles. Jonathan.
Good evening. Larry P. Arnn became the 12th president of Hillsdale College in 2000. He received his BA at Arkansas State University and his MA and PhD in government from the Claremont Graduate School. From 1985 to 2000, he was president of the Claremont Institute. He is the author of Liberty and Learning, The Evolution of American Education, and The Founder's Key, the divine and natural connection between the Declaration and the Constitution and what we risk by losing it. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Larry Arnn.
Good job, Mueller. Thank you, David Bob. Thank you all for coming. I should begin cheerfully, so happy Pearl Harbor Day. I actually do have some terrible things to say, but I promise to end hopefully, and I want you to know how glad I am to see you all and how hopeful, in fact, I am. We're in a terrible situation. We learned something in the election, and the thing is definite, and that is the most liberal administration in history running on a liberal platform has to be beat by excellent campaigning or it won't be beat. And most people I know, because I run in a narrow circle, were sure that this is so awful that it will be askewed and spewed out of the mouth of the American people, and it was not. And that's a fact, and we have to face that fact. It's also true that we're likely to be in the wilderness for a long time. The election was narrowly decided, but was what? Decisive? But decisive, Mr. Dimmers. Richard did that. Shut up, Richard. And it Richard's a friend of mine, I can say that. He's also married to a staff member. And so what's going on right now? You know, the economy is actually pretty good from one point of view. And that is, there's some growth. It's not terrible. It hasn't been in recession for quite a long time. And the people on food stamps and unemployed voted for the President of the United States' re-election. That's an interesting phenomenon, isn't it? The people hurt the most voted to the left, with the left in power. And that's one of many disturbing things that's going on in politics right now. And we are drawing all kinds of conclusions from that. For some reason, somebody last year negotiated a deal in which after the 2012 election, nothing was done, tax rates were going to go up on a bunch of people nobody wants to raise them on, and defense spending was going to be cut by very major amounts. And that deal is coming to fruition now, and the Republican Party finds itself in a terrible spot. And it's doing what it has been doing a lot of lately. It is quivering and trembling in fear. It surrendered and then had dirt kicked in its face. That's the events of the last 10 days. Now, maybe there'll be a deal. But I think whether there's a deal or not depends entirely on what the President of the United States wants. And the reason for that is, I think he's busy right now getting ready to win the 2014 election, God giving him strength, if it's God who provides that kind of strength. And I think if he wins it, he's going to get 2 more years to roll. But even if he doesn't get it, I think he thinks he can get a lot done, because a lot of things are happening this year and happening next year for which rulemaking have been going on for years now in healthcare and in finance, just to name two, that are going to change things in the country in a very big way. And of course, we know now, since I'm listing all the gloomy things, that there was this very large increase in the votes of various minorities and single women, and they did not vote in a conservative direction. Their turnout increased sharply in an election where turnout in all other categories fell. Obama's vote was down by several million from the time from 2008. But his vote among those peoples went up, and those people broke sharply for him. And their numbers are going to grow. And so it looks like, doesn't it, that we're in the situation, oh, by the way, our remedy to that is a new congressman, one of the smartest of congressmen, I'm not going to say his name, but he's a friend of mine and he's really great. And he said, well, our political strategy is there's a large group of people who hate us and won't vote for us no matter what, and so what we should do is add 9 million more of them to the voter rolls. That'll help. So it looks like Pearl Harbor, except we don't have a Navy or a capacity to build one. It's a terrible situation, isn't it? So I suggest give up. And thank you all for coming tonight. I will tell you that running a college is a lot of trouble and costs a lot of money, and we're thinking of closing it, there being no hope. And you know, the buildings are nice. Maybe I could live there for a while by myself. But you know, apart from giving up, there's another policy, by the way. Maybe it's time to join up. Because you know, if the economy's kind of okay through this terrible mess, and you know, the mess did arise in a very bad way in the last administration. Anybody else stay up nights in 2008 wondering if he's going to have any of his endowment left after 3 months? I got one. Still have it, proud to report. But for a while, I wasn't sure. And I have a theory about why that happened, and it's not all blamable on one party, but it didn't happen in this administration. And by the way, things have been rather better in many respects in this administration. As the president said when he ran, perhaps it's possible that the conditions are new now. Perhaps it's possible that we shouldn't give up. We should celebrate. We are reaching somewhere toward the end of history, and everything's going to be okay, although tax rates are going to be a lot higher. And by the way, everybody's going to get included, because one of the claims is that if you have large sections of the population who are left behind, that that's a terrible inefficiency. And if you take money from the people who are not left behind and give it to the people who are left behind, you'll have enormous gains. And you know, that's a claim, by the way, it's an argument. This could go on for a long time, and heck fire, who wants to worry about health insurance anyway if it can be taken care of for you eventually by the government? So if we don't give up, maybe we could join up. Those seem to be two of the options, and joining up would have some things you'd have to do, and you could do them. For example, I think it's time for us to embrace single motherhood. It's very common now. When I say embrace, I mean it figuratively and remind you all that I'm a married man. But it's very common, and the people who do it need a lot of help. And so it's the trend. And you know, it's a modern world, isn't it? I have my speech on this iPad here, right? I like it. It's really cool. You can see I even highlighted a bit so I wouldn't forget it. And it's all right there. And in a world like that where everything is changing, what about motherhood? What about the change in it? Couldn't we give more security if we just took care of all that? And here's another thing we're going to have to understand, and that is that it's a racially complex society now, not at all like it used to be. And so we should start recognizing the importance of race in human affairs, and we should wholeheartedly go on a campaign to treat people according to their race and make sure all of that comes out equal in some sense. So, for example, there are race preferences in federal law for Samoans. And I don't know what was done bad to those people, but they're heck of a good football player, a lot of them are. And I think, you know, maybe that's right. Maybe they should have that. And we should have this comprehensive system of handicapping. Because that's, by the way, what to join up. It means stuff like that. It does. I'll tell you why we can't give up. There's a famous story. So many of you here served in the famous saying. So many of you here served in the military. The saying is, you may not be interested in war, but war is very interested in you. And you can say exactly the same thing about politics. Human beings always live in political societies, and they always live under laws. And so we're going to have the force of the law in some direction or another. And if you can't give up and just let it go however it wants, then you got to think about joining up. And I'll tell you what's in the way of that. What's in the way of that is nature. And nature is a very strong thing. Jefferson, run it out the front door with a pitchfork and it'll be back in the back before you can turn around. Churchill, try to outrun nature at the gallop. You can't go that fast. Nature means birth. Comes from the Latin word for birth. The nature of things starts with its family, the way it grows. Look about this room at anybody who looks like they're under 25 or 30 years old, and there's a high likelihood that I had them in class. And that means that they were 21, 20, 19, or 18 when I did that. And I learned that if I called their families and announced myself, I would always say, "Hello, how are you? This is Larry Arnn, and everything's okay." Because if I didn't say that, they'd turn into blithering idiots. And even if everything wasn't okay, I would tell them it was okay just so I could talk to them. And these kids are 20 years old, and if they were anything other kind of creature, their parents would not know who they are by that time. And by the way, I can tell you that although they're very grown up and mature when they're 18 years old, not, they still very much need their families. Heck, one of my children had a meltdown over Thanksgiving. And the reason she did that, she's a mature and a professional woman now, but the reason she did that is because she was at home. She could do that. And if it takes, by the way, 2 decades minimum to raise a kid, and it's a big job when you do it, then how are you going to hire the labor to do that? And I've noticed that although I make a good living, it is very time consuming. And I, you know, we have 4 children in my household, and thank God for their mother. And that meant that it took 2 of us to do those 2 things, to make a living and have a child. And that just seems to me like a logical fact, unless you change. And by the way, let's say you try to hire it done. Then, since you need about 2.3 babies a family to replace the population, and if you don't replace it, when people get old, they will be neglected or victimized by strangers. That means every one of us in each generation has a stake in the perpetuation of the human race. It's not like we can pull down the shades and everything will be fine at the end of our life. And because it takes 2.3 and it takes 2 to raise them, how would you ever logically find enough labor to do it unless you do the thing that is being done on a very wide scale now, and that is raise them in groups by somebody other than their parents who have the natural love to give to them. And by the way, not many people who do that like it, and millions do. Come to find out, hard to join up with that. Race. It does just so happen that our college has the first charter of any college. Indeed, we think it may be the first charter of any organized institution in human history, with a charter that says, without regard to race, sex, and national origin, without regard. Of course, founded in the nation where that principle was first laid down. And yes, there was the blemish of slavery. Our college was founded to fight it, and the rolls of the dead who died on Union Army battlefields is very long. They paid the price for that, and they paid for it because they believed in it. And the claim was simple. Color is not a qualification to learn, nor to fail to learn. So I only know that we have had black ones in our college from the first days. There are records, but they do not indicate their race. They're photographs. Except for that, we would have no knowledge of the color of any student to the current day. I had a fellow say to me one time, I'm so proud that you never treated my son like he was black. And I replied, well, you know, if you look at him, he's not really black. He's more brown. And this man said to me, he sort of stepped, he's a lawyer in Detroit, he sort of stepped back and he said, you know, Dr. Arnn, you're kind of pink looking. But that's Lincoln's principle, isn't it? Lincoln's principle. You know, did you ever read his little logical fragment that he wrote on a scrap of paper? You say that I should be your slave because you are more intelligent than I. Take care. The next person you meet smarter than you is your master. You say that I should be your slave because the color of my skin is darker. Take care. You're going to meet one more pale than you. It's a logical point, isn't it? Human beings are the beasts that can talk, and that is their nature. Add to that the strange fact about them that they take so long to grow up. And by the way, think of that for a minute. You know how many people believe that self-interest is the mainspring of human society? I do. But by the way, isn't charity equally so? Because every baby would die if it were not closely tended, and it is no position to pay for that. Never will be. I'm hoping to make money off my kids. My dad used to say to me, he said, son, you make a good income, but I don't want your money. And I say, why not, Dad? And he said, it'd be demeaning to me to have it. Well, I feel the same, right? Would you die for your children? And by the way, if you wouldn't, you know, people ask me, what can you do about the inner city? And I always say the same thing. I always say, if there's a child in the inner city, if there's a living child in the inner city, At some point, someone has loved that child very much, or else it would be dead. And so you would go talk to them in their capacity as people who love young people. And they might be aunts or uncles or just mothers or just fathers or grandparents, but they're always somebody there, and the fact of the life of the child is the proof of that. And so are we going to surrender that? That would be surrendering the nature of man, and it is going to assert itself. And once I say that, I start getting into a place to turn more hopeful. There's one more thing about nature that is very worth thinking about, because we are approximating now a form of government that is unlimited. But that, too, is a matter of simple logic to figure out whether that's worthy or not. It is in the 51st Federalist where Madison, explaining why we need the Constitution, simply reminds us that men are not angels, and angels do not govern men. And so we need the restraints of the law, but the restraints of the law must play upon those who rule as well as those who are ruled. Put it in the classical way. There are two kinds of government, the ones that rule in the interest of the ruled and the ones that rule in the interest of the rulers. And any form of government, according to Aristotle, that grants unlimited authority to any small class or person is going, sooner or later, if not before, then surely when the succession happens to the next group, to become despotic. And that means to sign on, to join up to this, is to forget that the human family is written in the nature of man, and it is to forget that color has got nothing to do with anybody's credentials to do anything, except potentially get a suntan, I guess, although black friends of mine tell me they get burned. And also that human beings are not to exercise unlimited power, and I'll tell you what I mean specifically about that. Our arrangements are unique, the first in history. Great pride in the 63rd Federalist about them. And it's an amazing thing that they did, because what they did was they had, if you paint a big circle right here, that would be the society. And then there'd be a little bitty circle inside it, and that would be the government. And all of the authority over the government is in the big circle, but none of the ability to manage the government is in the big circle. So we are sovereign, but we rule only through elections. As the government gets bigger, it becomes extremely influential in elections. People from inside the government whose ideology and whose incomes and interests drive them that way are a major force and growing. And if nature prevails, and it's possible that it's been repealed by the iPad, but if it hasn't been repealed, you know, because I can tell you, the iPad is really cool. I don't know what I'd do without it. But you know, I never had one until about 3 years ago. But if it hasn't managed to repeal nature, then the first and fundamental hopeful thing is that nature is going to assert itself. And there will be opportunities in that. And there will be many. In fact, the opportunities are already present, and they can be measured. They just are not capitalized on. I should say one more gloomy thing. One of the worst things is the failure of statesmanship that's underway here. And I will tell you, we built this big old establishment in this town, and we came here to attempt to relieve the incredible ignorance that prevails in this town about anything old. I can tell you, the Constitution of the United States is pretty simple to understand, especially if you take the month it would take you, or year, to define the term politics so that you know what it is about a human being that makes them political. And once you do that, you can, you know, by the way, almost no one can do that. I torture the young with that question constantly. And that's the way I get them to understand that they're going to have to be able to define that term. Next time I see them, I'll ask them again. Marika, right back there. If you learn that, then you can learn the Constitution of the United States. But if you don't learn that, you just don't know what it means. And by the way, people in this town don't. It's a target-rich environment. If you're in the teaching business, you could work all day here in this town. And we need somebody who can explain the meaning of the country and the issues. For example, Obama says out loud, and God bless him for this, it's direct and powerful and clear. It would be better, he has said, to have tax rates that redistribute wealth even if it hurt the economy. It is a principle of justice that he proclaims. Was he answered? And he went from that to taunt the man for being rich. Was he answered? And by the way, $1.8 billion was spent running for president on the losing side. And they did not answer that basic argument about justice. What did they do? And you can think, like I always like it at the college when we have mess-ups, which is, you know, if it's a good day, two or three times. I always like to say, after we found out we did it, which is common, I always say, good, we did that. We can fix it, right? What if it was some terrible thing out in the universe, some force playing upon us, and we couldn't deal with it, right? That's gloomy. If we're screwing up, maybe we'll get better. But when it comes to statesmanship, the greatest one to live in the last 100 years did say that the genius of the statesman is much rarer than the largest and purest of diamonds. And because of that, wars, he said, are mainly tales of muddle. So that's not going to get better in a hurry. It'll get better in God's good time. And that's a caution. What we can do is learn and get better ourselves. Might recognize it when it comes and be of service. I say there are opportunities, I'll tell you. They line up with the three things I've just talked about. Nature asserts itself. And if you abandon it, there is misery. And people, by the way, are not fond of misery. People on welfare, by and large, would rather work. People who have children without a spouse would rather have one, by and large. I can tell you it's better. I don't know what I'd do without mine. We had a dinner in here the other night. George Will and I talked to a bunch of congressmen, about 50. Almost said who they were, but I'm not going to say. And one of them, a really great person, stood up and bemoaned the fact, and this was a woman, bemoaned the fact that they had lost women and they'd lost Asians and they'd lost Hispanics, she said, in the election. And they were weaker in those regards. And George gave her an answer, and then I said, you know, I said, are you pretty good at your job, or are you there because you're a woman? Am I doing that? And I don't have my iPhone. It's not that. I said, are you pretty good at your job, or are you just going to have it because you're a woman? And she stopped, and she said, that's right. Somebody needed to say that, right? And by the way, we didn't campaign among the Hispanics. And I'm not any great expert on the Hispanics, but the last time I checked, most of the Hispanics are sons and daughters, and very many of them are husbands and wives and mothers and fathers, and brothers and sisters too. And that's, you know, there should be some opportunity in that. Also, a very large number of them work for a living and pay taxes. And then there's the fact that a lot of them go to church. And do you realize, by the way, that I just named three sources, motives and sources of independence that are ineluctable in human nature? One is, if you have a family, you do not really, as a rule, want somebody else to take care of it. Do you want to raise your own children or do you want somebody else to? Right? Are parents not interested? You know one of the reasons why our college is popular? Our parents, there's two. You can ask them, right? If you come to Parents Weekend twice a year at Hillsdale College, you get to spend 10 minutes with every teacher your kids got. It's the cheesiest thing in the world. We set up these long tables, and we ring little bells so people can change. How many times have I had Marika's mother, who's sitting there by her, sit down beside me and go into the details of her life, right? And the point is, That connection is very powerful, right? And Marika's mother and Kayla's mother and father, I'm morally certain that they trust me, a lot even. I try to be worthy of it. But trust but verify. It's their kid, you know? So you see the point? Those people, the brown ones, have that too. You ever met anybody who started a business? Anybody in here do it? I did. Made it work too, right? Jealous about it? Stay up nights sweating about it? Worry about it while you watch it grow? Afraid it's going to be engulfed? Don't look to other people to take care of it? Think it's your business? Of course you've got to serve your customers. Of course you require a society with the rule of law in it. And by the way, people stood up in this room at the beginning and talked about how they'd paid for that. But that doesn't mean somebody else owes your business. And people of every color have that experience. They have families and they have businesses. And then that third thing. We live in an age in which we think everything is changing because we like gadgets and gewgaws and flying around. I do. I like all those things. I don't like to fly, actually, because I do it too much. And so we think everything is changing. But you know, people who go to church don't think that, by and large. Well, it depends on the church these days, but most of them. You know, my bishop sits back over there. He doesn't think that. He thinks there's this eternal God, the definer of nature itself. And the distinction between man and God is a gulf so wide that it can never be bridged except by the grace of God, right? And that is an eternal fact. And that means that everywhere there are families, and everywhere there are people of faith, and everywhere there are businesses, there are people who want their independence. And why on earth we don't develop the tongue to talk to those people, whatever their color, and tell them what's coming? It seems to me we won't know we were beat till we do that. And the opportunities for that must grow because of the direction of things. Right now, it is a deeply troubled population. Show it the truth. Churchill said, "There is a chord in the heart of man. Pluck it, and it resonates around the world." Isn't that lovely? And that meant, in 1940, when they were completely outnumbered, why was he hopeful? He thought two things. He thought, that thing that overwhelmingly powerful man is doing will not work. And so you have to count on it. It is a weakness. It will fall. And the second is, call upon free people. Their numbers are infinite, and they will come. And they did. Abraham Lincoln, same thing. No army, cities surrounded. And then he sounded a call. And what is it? 450 miles from here on the frontier. There's some people he knew there, actually. But most of them he didn't know. And he didn't know what they'd been doing in the last month. And what happened was, all the boys went to fight. There were no boys left. And they changed some battles, the Battle of Gettysburg. Why did they go? They'd been reading about their freedom. Nobody taught them any military stuff. And they knew what their freedom was. And until we do that, we cannot know that we're beaten. I want to close with a plan. It's simple. I've been thinking about it a lot lately because we don't have one. And one of Churchill's favorite things to say, he said, one time he said it, I'll tell you the most dramatic place he said it. In 1915, he was screaming because they were losing 10,000 boys a day in the trenches, and the generals had actually calculated how many young men there were in Britain and France, and calculated that there were more in Germany, and so Germany was going to run out first. And he was horrified by that. And one day he stood up in the cabinet and he pounded his fist. He wasn't given to that. And then he went off, by the way, himself and joined the army and fought in the trenches. He said, those brave young men who die every day, 10,000 a day, have a cause already. They do not need you for that. They need you for a plan. You are to make them a plan. And I don't think anybody in this country, is in the politics, in this city, is competent to make a plan. So I will suggest one. And I will begin by saying, I don't know how to save the country. I know how it was done. It has been done before. And we can't be sure that that will work. But if we think that there's a nature, then we must believe that there is some guidance in what was done. And I can tell you, it's been done twice in American history. And it was done the same way both times. And it was done by very great people who, by the way, never proclaimed that about themselves, although I think they knew it. They made a plan. And the plan had three parts. And you'll see, by the way, it's really simple. And the three parts could be united easily. If, by the way, you can start with the first, because that takes some learning. The first thing is, it started with some principles. And I want you to understand, I'm not giving you a list. I am describing an integrated whole, something that will operate as a single force. Because that's what happened in the Revolutionary War and in the Civil War. The principles were just overwhelmingly clear when Abraham Lincoln or Thomas Jefferson talked about them. You know, when they were struggling, did you ever read the summary view of the rights of British North America? The way the American Revolution developed was, it started in confusion and it ended in a death struggle. But along the way, between confusion and death struggle, there were these steps that came. And the steps would have an act of violence or force, and then they would be matched by an acceleration in the rhetoric. And as they went down the line, it got really serious when Thomas Jefferson decided to write something. Because God gave that man to speak, made that man to speak of freedom. And you can read Daniel Delaney, and you can read James Otis, and you can read all these guys, and these guys are really great, but they are not Thomas Jefferson. And when it gets time for Jefferson to write, he closes this address to the king 2 years before in a foretaste of the Declaration of Independence, and the whole country shook over it. Open your breast, sire, to the rights of man. Let those flatter who fear it is not an American art. And then the paragraph continues, you see. You are a servant. You must comport yourself this way. You must take your counselors from those you rule. You are entitled to no other. Now, is that a way to speak to a king who would soon have a warrant out to you for your arrest? A warrant not to policemen, to an army. A general received it. Find these men and bring them here to England. You see? That's how he talked, right? And it was beautiful. If every drop of blood drawn by the lash through 200 years of the bondsman's unrequited toil must now be repaid with another drawn by the sword, still it will be said that the ways of the Lord are righteous altogether. That's from the second inaugural address of Lincoln. It is a judgment upon us. We must do right in order to make up for wrong. And when people heard things like that, they were moved. They wept over it. But also, the situation was clear. But that only raises the question. That's why these three things are integrated. That only raises the question, what do you do now? And in all the cases, in the Civil War and in the Revolutionary War, nothing was done until it had to be done. Everybody wanted to compromise. Nobody wanted a big shebang. But then it had to be, right? And what happened in the Revolutionary War was he had so many soldiers there, and he proposed these taxes, and he was going to use these taxes to pay these soldiers to make the colonists do what he said. And they could see they were losing control of the situation. And if it goes on any farther, it'll be the end. By the way, that's coming to us somewhere in the future. And we're going to find out if we still have the stuff in us as it draws near. You see? But then what happened in the Civil War? Nobody wanted to deal with slavery. Nobody did. Not Abraham Lincoln didn't want to deal with it. But they had to deal with it because there was this land opening up and people were going there at a pace. And we've never been any good at stopping Americans from going to free land, open land. Actually, we've gotten better at that now. And so something had to be done because it's either going to be slave territory or it's going to be free territory, and it's going to be that right now. So now, all of a sudden, we've got to deal with slavery. And so those policies, you see, they demanded, they had these features that one looks for. I suggest we look for these features now. It has to be an issue that is fundamental, that touches on the principles of the regime, involves them closely. And therefore, by the way, when they come up, they will divide the parties for sure. And then a choice. They have to be something where a choice is coming and it's got to be made. At some point about the entitlements, that's true. At some point about this race stuff, that's true. At some point about the principles of our foreign policy, that's true. Can we run it, our national security policy, can we run it in the interest of protecting the rights of the American people? Should we choose our allies carefully and with tight restrictions, only those that help with that? And should we be ruthless and effective in the pursuit of that goal? Should people quiver around the world at the thought of offending the rights of the American people? Are we going to do that or are we not? Because if we're not, we're not going to be able to travel abroad and we're going to be hunted in our own land. And that's all coming, by the way. And that means we don't know when those issues, and those are three examples. And by the way, 10 examples would be too many. But those three examples at some point are going to require to be decided. And we should be studying those things and developing our arguments. And then finally, people is the third thing. Who are the people in the United States of America who will rally to save our country, and how can we reach those people? And we know who they are. And we know that they spread across lines of color and sex. They are located in every corner of the land. And it is, by the way, ungenerous and wrong to launch a national campaign and fail to seek those people everywhere, to make a close calculation that I'm going to win by this much so I don't rock the boat. Do you think Abraham Lincoln or Winston Churchill or Ronald Reagan were ever able to be restrained from speaking their mind, the things they loved and had learned to articulate? And so you got to go look for the people. And the doing of those three things is not that hard. And I will tell you something. In 1844, when our college was founded, it went working on those three things. In 1854, in July, the Republican Party, hardly anything at all at the time, met to have a convention and proposed a platform document. And the chairman of the convention was Austin Blair, a Hillsdale College faculty member, and to this day, the greatest governor in Michigan history. And the vice chair was the president of the college, Edmund Fairfield. The faculty love it that the president became the lieutenant governor and the faculty member became the governor. Some things change in history. And they wrote out this platform, and it's the one that Lincoln won on in 1860. And it included those three things. What is the principle? Which is simple. This is Tom, my colleague at the college, Tom West, a politics teacher, great one. I keep quoting him because he came up with this brilliant idea. The slogan should be the slogan of the Populist Party in the 1890s. Equal rights for every American. Special privileges for none. Did you hear anybody say that in this campaign? And that means there was no choice presented between those two things, and one of them is the exact heart of the United States of America, and it did not come up. Well, it came up in our college in 1854. And then they say, what are we going to do about slavery? Because there's got to be something to do, you see. There's not just a cause, there's a plan. And the thing to do is easy to state. We are not going to destroy the Constitution and invade the states. The Constitution is precious. And we are not going to tolerate slavery indefinitely. We are going to stop it spreading any further. We have the legitimate power under the Constitution to stop it going anywhere. And that policy was invented in significant part on my campus. And it was the key that unlocked that two-generation-long problem. It caused the war because those who wanted slavery could see they were beaten. And then finally, people. It contains an appeal to fellow citizens in every corner of the land, free states and slaves, to return to the faith of the fathers who built America, because it is the greatest country in human history, at least surely in the modern world. And it is ours, and it has been good to us, and we owe it. And it looks to me like those three things can be done, and they are going to be done shortly. And then they will be spread abroad about the country, and we will see if the American people are still Americans. And that will work. And I will close with a happy note. Merry Christmas.
We're going to have some time for a few questions, so if you would just wait for the mic to come to you, and then you can ask your question.
I thought we were going to have a Christmas party now. Yes, sir.
Yes, I have a question about secession. As I'm sure you've heard, some states have considered secession. And I think there are lawsuits, and I think probably at least 90% of the lawsuits between states and the federal government, the states are probably on the right side. We can admit that. Several years ago, there was a Quebec secession movement, and I was really afraid that if that succeeded, all these Atlantic provinces would be hanging out here with Quebec in between the rest of Canada. And I didn't like the geographical contiguity there, and I prefer James Polk's geographical contiguity. But I'm wondering, is there any particular situation where secession is really advisable, and or is it a disciplinary thing, something like sequestration or fiscal cliffs or nuclear weapons, where you just threaten to do it and don't actually do it?
So let's adopt a policy of bluffing. Well, secession is not a constitutional policy. It's not mentioned there, right? And it just simply isn't true that the state governments created the Union. And we have the testimony of James Madison, who lived into the nullification and secession crisis about this. See, the way the Union works is this. The reason the Constitution has the authority it has is this. It's actually very beautiful. The people of the United States as a people have only ever made one law. And the process was organized in their states. They elected ratifying conventions for the single purpose of ratifying the Constitution. And then those were dissolved, and that process goes away. And what we're left with is not the state governments owning the federal government, because, by the way, that means that then the state governments can act for the people and have some kind of ownership over them. Such a great ownership as to be able to disband their union that they made. And that's just, so as a constitutional policy, it doesn't make a blind bit of sense. What every one of us has, and has it all the time, and has it right now, and can use it when we think it right, is the right of revolution. And it could come to that, but not while we're voting and living under our union. We'd be disobeying the greatest law on earth, the Constitution of the United States. So I don't think there's a solution there. And also, I personally, it does occur in the founding, it's true, but I wouldn't use the rights of states, because I think people have rights. States have authorities that come from people who give them those rights. And states are not inherently any more trustworthy than the federal government. The argument between the Federalist and the Anti-Federalist turns on a point like that, because the Anti-Federalists are arguing, among many things, that if it's more local, it's safer. And the Federalist response to that is not, if it's more central, it's safer. Their argument is, every unchecked use of human power, even in the individual human breast, is suspect. And that means local is not necessarily better, and national is not necessarily better. The proper structure is better. And then we can all be encouraged to act our age or older. Yes, sir.
I was a committee counsel for Congress for 14 years. And I look back on that time, and I cannot think of a time when I saw a member of Congress willingly give away power. And it occurred to me that perhaps this is an elemental force in human nature, the desire of people whose careers are dedicated to power to accumulate it. And my question is, this election was fought over which politicians we were going to send to Washington to exercise power. What do you think of the idea that what we really ought to be talking about is which politicians are we going to send to Washington to give power back so that we restore some of the balance between state power and federal power that the authors of the Constitution intended that seems to have been forgotten now?
Good idea. And about that, I would say that when you talk about policy issues, it strikes me, the art is to cast them in their constitutional dimension. And nobody's very good at that right now. Although a couple of people in Congress, one just elected, is going to be good at it, and one who's been around for a while because he's a really great guy, and my friends and I are beating the crap out of him. And he's got the capacity to learn. But here's what you're going to have to do, right? First of all, our government is supposed to be limited. And limited can mean a range of things, depending on whether we got a war on or stuff. But it must mean it can't be big enough to overawe the private society. We should start talking about that. Our government is supposed to be representative. I'm naming you the three things the Constitution is about, three main things about it. The second is it's got to be representative. And remember, large parts of the government, most of it by far, is completely unrepresentative now. And there's hay to make there if anybody would make it, because people don't like the bureaucracy. And people don't like these public employee unions. Do you know that Michigan, for God's sake, which is, I mean, talk about squirrely politicians. We have a monopoly, you'd think. They're about to pass right to work in Michigan. And there's a public opinion in favor of that. In Michigan, you know, the Michigan Education Association is the first public employee union, the founder of the National Teachers Union, and the United Auto Workers grew out of Detroit, right? So what I would do, people don't like these special privileges. Remember that formula I copied from Tom West, equal rights for every American, special privileges for none. And I think that we should pass the RAINS Act. And what that thing says, you have it in your pocket. Amazing guy. And what that thing says is that any bureaucratic regulation involving more than X in expense has to be ratified by Congress and signed by the president, or it sunsets in 90 days. That makes the government representative again. And finally, you have to have separation of powers. And federalism is a subset of the conception separation of powers. And that means that you're going to have to encourage the executive to get back to making the laws and not appointing czars and ruling by executive order. And the legislature has got to get out of the business of being ombudsman for every little cause and being like administrators, each one a fiefdom unto himself. And the judges have got to stop making laws and start ruling on the law as it exists. And you got to make arguments for that, and that will breed respect for the Constitution. And then in the fullness of time, only after the victory is won, then you can repeal the 17th Amendment, a great thing to do. Because then what that does, understand, is in the system that was set up, the reason it has lasted so long, is Madison understands that the branches require protection from each other. So the president is given the veto, a part of the legislative power. The legislature is given oversight, part of the executive power. The judges are given judicial review, part of the legislative power. The states are given control of the Senate of the United States. And that is a big thing that has changed the country. and that has got to be reexamined. But don't aim for that, because, by the way, anybody who runs for office saying he's so in favor of a thing that he favors a constitutional amendment about it is just telling you he's not going to do anything. Because constitutional amendments can only be passed after you've won the political battles and they're settled. That's when they happen. Yes, sir.
Despite the expenditure of a lot of money recently in a lot of elections, the conservatives in general and Republicans in particular were unsuccessful in communicating these basic ideas to enough folks. Results speak for themselves. I understand that the Republican governors recently got together and said, we agree with that, and we're going to try and do it differently because we need to communicate. My comment is, do you think they can do that? How, when you might suggest they go about that? And furthermore, if we don't do it in the next 2 years, we're in big trouble because 3 years and out, what's going to happen is probably going to happen. So perhaps your comments on how we can really communicate with the folks that we didn't communicate with in the recent past.
Well, the reason the national ticket didn't communicate well is because at the top, at least, they didn't know what to say, right? It's very difficult to articulate beautifully a thing that you don't understand, and also, therefore, don't set out to articulate. I think there's a public opinion out there worried about the size and awkwardness of the government, and if you could talk about how to make it effective and how to return it within its bounds, and how people would be taken care of. Like, what you got to show, like, you know, Dennis Titty's there, and he works for Paul Ryan. And Paul Ryan has done just a wonderful work on entitlements. And, you know, the Ryan bill, in the strict understanding of the Constitution, is unconstitutional. But it's a step back toward the Constitution, and Ryan has got to get better at justifying it on those terms and explaining why it's a step back that way. And that's how you do it, right? Because then it's not just a policy proposal, it is a resurrection of the central principles of the land. And Congressman Ryan, a friend of mine whom I admire very much, is getting better at speaking in that language. And these governors need to do the same thing. And also, you know, I give you a counter example. As I say, I had endless patience for the campaign of Governor Romney when I thought he was going to win. I thought, you know, he's not very good, but who cares? He's going to win. And I can go back to my work, you know. I got a really great job. Well, in the first debate, he said, I believe that regulation is necessary. You can't have business or the economy without regulation. And then I erupted at that. My wife said, shh. She didn't like me to erupt at the television. But here's what he should have said. He should have said, I don't believe in regulation. I believe in law. And laws are brief and clear, and we can all obey them and help to enforce them and help to make them because they're simple. And look at this ugly thing you have passed, which is 2,200 pages long. That's two of them, by the way, are that. But that's not the measure of their length. The rulemaking has gone on for months now, and there are thousands of additional rules. So the truth is, you should learn to denounce that because people should understand it, that it's bad. And that, did I mention this? I want to emphasize this. This form of government sets up, rewards, and then belongs to a privileged class that runs things. They're all around here, right? And that's ugly, and it's elitist, and people are not liking that. Look at the election results in Wisconsin. Look at that vote I mentioned in Michigan. Americans don't like special privileges. Why don't you run and point that out? Because remember what I said. It's not like they can discard that. Their form of government. Let me explain what I mean by form of government. A form is something you can see, right? So go look at the Capitol and the White House and the Supreme Court building. Where would you put 5,000 bureaucrats in there? And see, the architecture is all wrong for that. You couldn't fit them, right? Go look at the Department of Education, if you can bear it. And it's custom made for that kind of thing. And by the way, I run a college. And I read, I don't very often, I confess it, because I can't bear it. But I sometimes read what they write about education. It is generally dog dumb. They don't know the first thing. They don't know, for example, that the kids do the learning. And if they don't want to, you can't teach them. That, you know, entitlement to education, right? Like I could teach Matthew Taylor back there, Aristotle, if he wasn't paying attention. But by the way, it's not just paying attention. You got to work. There is stress of soul. And, you know, you get to these paragraphs in Aristotle's Ethics, and they're beautiful, but sometimes they're complicated. And I'll get somebody to read it out, and I'll say, what did that mean? And then about six people will take a stab, right? And it's only after that process where you, after 40 years of work, have some idea what it means, and then you say, and they go, wow, okay. If you did that to start, they wouldn't pay a bit of attention. They'd think it'd been easy. You see, that's education. But first of all, remember, in the form of government with which the United States was established, there is no place for those people in this city. And that has been built later, and it can be recognized by its ugliness. Point that out to people. They always laugh when I say it.
We have time for one more question.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Dr. Arnn, we're the Birches from Texas and California. I'm really concerned about the next generation. There's so much influence from the left, owning the movie industry, owning television, owning music, children's television, and the media. How on, and the liberals seem to have the corner on cool. So how on earth are we going to influence today's children, the next generation, for to give them the hope of wisdom and what's right over what's cool?
Wait, I'm pretty cool. So we're ending this with a crushing blow. Isn't the answer to that obvious? Things that are ugly are not cool. Things that don't work are not cool. And you can dress them up with rhetoric for a while, but the truth is a very powerful thing. Right. I mean, remember what I said. The family is a natural fact. And if you abandon it, we will suffer. And the suffering will be felt, and it will breed opposition. Color, counting people by their color, divides society into tribalism, and it produces ugly relations. And people will not like that. And it doesn't matter whether you're cool or not. You're not cool if you think that. If you deny the great truth of that, special classes of people with title to rule, seeking and advancing towards sealing themselves off from the opinions of those they rule, that will breed despotism. Despotism is not cool. And so, by the way, you could teach that in school if you run a good school. But the way you run a good school is you get everybody to sign up. They've all got to agree. Everybody. You know, the way we recruit to Hillsdale College, let me say, I see some young people sitting there. If you come to our college, it'll be hell. Just hell. And you got to want that or you'll never make it. And you can go somewhere else and it'll be a lot easier and you'll have more fun. Okay, well, if you recruit that way, you get a bunch of people who show up and they're ready to go now, right? They think, okay, it's hell, let's go, you know. You see, the point is, that's cool. But if you don't learn it that way, then you're going to learn it the hard way. But learn it you will. I'm speaking now with the voice of doom. That's how things are. And we can't make them different just because we want to. Thank you.